Hello and welcome everyone to Crow Marmot Commentary. In the room, myself, of course, Ken Navarro, and right next to me, Michael Lippy Lipman.
Hi everybody, this is Lippy.
And also in the studio is Jim Lively.
Hello.
Sound engineer. So, Crow Marmot, again, harking back to the second DVD, I guess. Our original idea was to, we really wanted to get guest directors to come in and have fun with the characters and stuff like that, and just create their own kind of cartoon off of our characters. So with that in mind, we got in touch with Lippy on this third DVD. Lippy, who is also, by the way, for you HTF aficionados, is the voice of Nutty. And he's just as crazy. We got in touch with Lippy.
Well, Ken is being very gracious here. Actually, I beg Ken and Rhodey to let me work on this thing. They were looking at some black and white reference material, and they knew that I was a real fan of this old black and white Birth of Sound stuff. And so he called me up and said, hey, Lip, do you have anything we can look at? So I slipped this note in to the DVDs,
yes.
Right?
You remember that?
And I said, Ken, please, you know, oh, if there's any chance at all, remember your friends. So
no, Rhodey and I always knew that Lippy was the man for this job. So, but that was the time when we were trying to get an idea if this was even possible, you know, and all this stuff. So, and obviously it was, you know, we produced it and stuff like that. And we'll be going through some of kind of the creation, the birthing of this whole
the birth pangs.
Exactly. Yeah. Normally in the show, he's just frozen in a block of ice. So in this one, we obviously wanted him to be animated and moving around and stuff like that. And again, the other thing we wanted to try is make it really look old-timey and get that really kind of rubber-hosey, very Steamboat Willie kind of look. So what you're seeing right now is one of the concept sketches that Rhodey drew up just to get that kind of feel. You'll notice his limbs are a little longer than, you know, regular Happy Tree Friend characters, and he's just slightly a little different, and we wanted to see how far we can take that experiment, I guess.
Yeah, when I took a look at this, when I talked to you and Rhodey originally, I said to Rhodey, show me whatever you've got. And when he pulled these out, I could see that he was really thinking mostly, or both you guys, was the rubber hose stuff. And everything else had not been really thought through. It was just like, we know it kind of, you know, it should look old and all that kind of Fleischer-esque stuff. So this was actually, it was good that you guys hadn't gone too far down a road, because then I felt a lot freer to just start to go through, you know, part of the fun for me was all the homework, and I could start to look through old books and rip everybody off of.
Yes, that's what we're all about here at Happy Tree Friends, is ripping other people off.
Yeah, so I just go to the library.
Paying homages to it.
Oh, there's lots of those in this.
We toyed around with giving him gloves and stuff like that, which I think we ended up giving him gloves, but it was really, you know, those funny Mickey Mouse gloves that everybody had back in those days.
Well, you know, what I found out when I started doing the research was that the reason, of course, they had those gloves was because they were doing the artwork on paper before cells. So they were actually doing black, they were filling with black ink these bodies, and they needed some gloves so that the hands would read in front of the bodies. And I started finding that in the same way when I started doing backgrounds and realizing kind of one of the early things I realized was the character should be the blackest thing in the frame, and he'll pop. And so when, in a little while, we'll talk about the background design, but that's one of the first things I said to Jenny Hansen was, okay, the background should really fade out into just middle shades of gray, and the darkest thing in the frame will be Crow Marmot's body. And then, of course, with those white gloves, boom, they pop right in front.
Again, when we were trying to get across, you know, the vision of what we wanted to Lippy here, we just wanted, this was kind of like a rough kind of background treatment of what we thought, you know, the landscape might look like. Rhodey and I really love these kind of hanging rocks, these kind of Warner Brothers.
I know, you know, I'm looking at this now and thinking I should have looked at this closer, because to tell you the truth, I love those hanging rocks that are just balancing precariously on the top of the mesas.
Yeah.
That would have been cool.
So these were just fun backgrounds, yeah. You know, that we thought.
We'll do that on the sequel.
Yes, yeah. Sure. More precariously balanced rocks. It's good times.
Yeah, this was it. This was basically the four drawings that I got from you guys after we had a lunch discussion eating some, I think, very spicy meat sauce.
Hunan, yeah, right? We don't give Lippy a lot.
They gave me a lot of meat
sauce. That's pretty much it. It's like, here's the four drawings, Lip. See you later.
Bye. Now remember those rocks.
Okay, this guy's looking pretty shady.
Yeah, wow. This is my first sketch. So I have this Crow Marmot, don't ask, you know. It was one of those days. And I had it tacked to my drawing board, and then I just started thinking, okay, what do I need? So the first thing I did was I tried to stretch him to even facilitate more of the rubber hose stuff.
I like his weird nappy shaggy hair.
Yeah, you know, I gave him this weird gorilla kind of animal. I was trying to make him animal style, you know, put a little mustard and some onions into him.
All right, so this is, I guess we're getting closer here. It's coming back more towards Chrome Armit, but that one on the right has a tail.
Right. I was playing like, well, you know, this was when I, again, you know, doing that homework thing, which is a lot of fun. I actually went online and went to like marmot.com and looked up pictures of marmots, right? I did.
Isn't that an illegal site?
Well, it is now, kids, because I just bought the domain, so now it's a porn site. So I found that they're related to squirrels. And so I started thinking, oh, you know, they have fluffy tails.
Well,
and,
I didn't even know they were related to squirrels.
Look at the things you learn.
Exactly. See, here, kids, we're learning and sharing.
Well, I thought, well, you know, maybe since he's in his case, in his precursor days and the formation of the character, maybe he should have had a tail back then. So I was messing with that. I started to streamline his face. On the left, I was trying to work out the black tones. I knew he needed to be blacker so that he would pop on that over that background, and I started to get a little alarmed that everything I was doing was white, and
because of course there's no color in Chrome Armit's world.
Yeah,
there's
he's
a lot
mono
of gray,
monochrome Armit.
A lot of gray area. Pretty close. This is almost what he turned out to be with, you know, a couple of small changes and stuff like that.
At this point, I was looking at this still thinking, you know, this character isn't cute enough. There's a problem here. I didn't like the way the head was working with the body. You know, it's just kind of unpleasing shapes. And mostly because the proportions were very similar. The head was about the same size as the body. And that's kind of character design 101. You got to mix up those proportions. So I hadn't done that yet. Now,
really mixing up proportions.
Yeah, right. Well, then I started.
It's always extremes with Lippy. It's one way or the other.
Well, I started. No, actually, that's right. I thought, well, let's just really push it then. So this little guy running on the left was, let's
like
make a huge head. And actually, he became incredibly.
He's got, like, gigantism or something.
Yeah, well, he became a lot cuter to me.
He did.
Yeah, right. And I thought, like, oh, this is going to work. Now, that's a little too much. I really can't animate him because his body is so small. Again, I thought it was much more interesting than the guy on the right. This may have been the last drawing I did where he had that caveman full-on Tarzan suit thing, because I started to realize I need more black there, and I might just have to give him a breech cloth. Coincidentally, the breech cloth! Let's see, there's some fun stuff here. Down in the bottom of the picture, you'll see a disembodied leg.
Foot.
And foot, thank you. That was a total ripoff of a classic cartoon from a major studio that we won't name. And I just started seeing...
it's an homage.
Yeah, I started seeing they would just take the simpler the better, and I started to realize, hey, man, I got to simplify this guy. So I'm starting to get closer on the proportions on the right, and I think the next big thing that happened was, I took his feet down, and we may have even... At one point, I got rid of his cub-like ears. So this was kind of a breakthrough because... I realized that if I put these old 30s...
Floppy ears?
Yeah, like these old ears where he actually had that kind of old-style dog kind of, you know, unspecific animal species thing. It would start to read better. And so now the feet are getting smaller, the ears are coming on, and pretty much the last thing I needed to do after this was I changed his nose where... I don't even know if I have any drawings of that. That happened... Like, literally at the last minute. I think I was already in Flash and had electronified it when I realized...
Electronified.
Must put big jelly bean nose.
What the hell is going on here?
Okay, so look at his proportions here. He's in this swing, and these are pretty much the proportions he ended up being.
Who's this guy sleeping down here, Lip?
That's, that's... Was that you taking a nap?
Well, you know, when you're sketching, you got to go somewhere.
So
you do that.
That's so random with the big feet.
Yeah, you know, you got to go somewhere and then you come back.
I don't know what's going on down here. It's
he's
scary.
Like he's
going
to kick him in the teeth or something.
Well, are you sure this is for this guy?
This is for DVD only. What you're looking at is a takeoff on a snail character. And when you look at the animatic that I did for...
Right after this section, we'll run the animatic, and you'll see there's actually a scene that we had cut with this kind of snail character.
Yeah, so I was just getting loose and drawing this snail, and I started working out these hands. Now this probably was a day that I was really working on getting these gloves right. And you'll see this hand in the upper right actually is pretty darn close to a hand that I used when there's a close-up of his stomach roaring like a lion. Okay, you heard it here first. Look for that hand because as an extra bonus point, watch how many times I use that hand because it turned out so well. I really liked it that I used it ad infinitum.
Cheap. So this is the first animatic that Lippy came in with and showed us.
Yeah, you're looking at a screen there. That was a ripoff of Flip the Frog from an old Ub Iwerks cartoon where I just put a rough chrome marbon on top of that.
So this is very, very early, laying out everything and figuring out what we wanted him to do and stuff like that. I know Rhodey and I wanted to do do the classic, like, comes out and just dancing to the beat, those old cartoons used to do.
Yeah, it's great. It was just an excuse to just do kind of pure acting there. Oh, there's that hand I was talking about.
So here he gets hungry, and here's the scene that we were talking about earlier with the snail.
Cute snail.
Isn't he cute? No, this is.
Yeah. He tries to eat him, and he bites him in the tongue.
I think he's gonna do a little handy move there. So then he's hungry again. So we felt like basically I didn't have time to do that with the production schedule. I didn't have time to actually animate that thing, and it was fine. It was a redundant gag. This is affectionately known as Burger Bun. This section, and this is basically Ken and Rhodey's gag. Great gag. All of this stuff.
It's a much more ominous dinosaur in this one.
Yeah. And this thing played out pretty long. We didn't know if this was ever going to work. And so, actually, it didn't. So we cut this in about half.
Yes, this is the raptor.
Okay. Cartoon zip there.
This is one of the very earliest, actually, tests that you showed us, Lippy, run cycle.
Yes!
Had to get rid of that gesture.
Oh, he's pulling that. Oh, that was one of my favorite. I always loved. Oh, now that's what I really liked. Yeah.
Swing. Oh, we had a scene here.
Should we talk about
that? Our original intent there was for him to swing across and scream kind of like Tarzan-esque, but Lippy thought that would be a little. It'd be better if he stuck his tongue out instead.
Oh, you're being so gracious. Well, I just thought that we haven't heard from Crow. He doesn't really have a voice, and I thought that kind of a sound gag wasn't going to play as well as if we could do something with a little more personality and show him to be cocky. And right at the moment of his extreme cockiness, he gets chomped. So that's about it. Okay, so here you're seeing an alternative chew on the bird when he's chewing Crow. I worked through a lot of these. They weren't working very well, and this was actually a vomit reference, which came pretty quickly.
I like the vomit juice.
I like this is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what makes it. Look for it. Okay, this
nice.
Yeah, this was just a run that I totally ripped off of Richard Williams' animation book for all you nerds out there.
More run reference.
Yeah, this is a Bill Tytla run that came down through the ages, some Xerox 2020 versions later. This one I actually did all by myself.
Wow.
Yeah, can you thank you,
yes,
me?
Nice.
Yeah, I didn't rip that off of anybody.
Nice. I love the club dragging. It's great.
Yeah, I did the club first, as you can see. I got that rhythm going, and then I did the body.
Beautiful.
Yeah, these are all the same way. Just trying to get the weight of this guy. These all happened in one day. I got all those things. I kind of had a breakthrough where I realized I could actually do roughs before I animated. This is the same day. I did all these the same day. And then it was just a matter of laying the Flash assets over it, so that worked out really well. This is a total ripoff of Ub Iwerks, and I feel no compunction or shame about this. That was great. I actually traced those frames. Okay, this is the mighty Ted Pratt's first pass on doing a computer animated background for this opening walk shot that we call the turntable shot. This is a total homage to the early Fleischer films of the 30s where they would actually create clay backgrounds and walk the animation in front of it. So Ted and I were working on this all the time in the background. Ken and Rhodey were totally nervous about this. They said, Lip, like, it's going to look like a computer background. I said, you guys, if it looks like a computer, I have failed, and we won't do it. There's other ways to do it.
That was the promise, and he was going to give us $5.
That's right, and a bottle of you know, sweet juice. But Ted, to his credit, you know, who was learning Maya modeling and lighting on the fly. Ted's a fantastic animator, but had never really done that before. So you're looking at all of the different stages here. Yeah, and the guy was just, the guy is a total Fleischer freak anyway. So we had a real shorthand going, and he knew exactly what I wanted. And
they were the team.
Yeah, it's just, Ted, all kudos to him. It just looked fantastic. It's great. People look at it and they don't even know what they're looking at. Like they'll say, "Is that a painting?" Is it? And then I tell them, "No, we actually did it in clay."
So this is the final production after all that trouble.
Yeah. Now you're looking at a lot of technique here, a lot of old time technique that was done by Peter Herman, just a fantastic After Effects work. This is not just push a button, folks, and give me the old time look. Peter has about 20.
That's Lippy's hand, by the way, for you.
Right. My wife took that. So anyway, I was saying that there's a lot of presets involved, and Peter just did a fantastic job. You're looking at Ted's final shot here of the clay background, and
beautiful.
Yeah,
shadow.
Look great, at that. Just the way it's flickering. It's just fantastic. All the flickers, Peter, of course. And that's a total another Ubi Works ripoff. Okay, now look at these beautiful backgrounds by Jenny Hansen coming up here.
This Jenny Hansen, who you will know is our colorist on the show.
Right, so I gave Jenny a bunch of screenshots from old Ubi Works and early Disney and Fleischer films from the late 20s and 30s. She totally nailed it. Look at that. Look how faded the background is. There's the beauty shot coming up, which I'll talk about, which is Jenny's crowning achievement, I think. Her clouds.
This gesture here is really Lippy. That is so Lippy. This is great. I love the scene. My favorite here is when he picks up his guts and runs off with it. That's great. Right here.
And all that sound was created here right in the studio. Custom two picture.
Absolutely. Jim was pretty much insistent upon as much analog sound effects as we could get. So we've got some really cool coconut. Oh, by the way, that was that beauty shot, that upshot. Oh, well, wait. There it is again. Jim, so we did a lot of guts. We did a lot of pasta, oily pasta.
Coconuts.
So yeah, this was originally going to be a Tarzan gag. Ouch, ouch, that kind of thing. And I just thought it might be nicer if he was a little, at his moment of supreme cockiness, he gets supremely chewed up and messed up. Yeah, and here's another beautiful setup. This was the first background that Jenny did where I knew that it was really going to work, that it was going to look like 30s. And here we go. Everybody's got to have a bib. I wear one every day. Bibbing a diaper.
The end.
So you should probably mention the music.
Stephen Wirth at Vintage Ink and Paint. He was selling some old ragtime discs on his site, and he came through with us in a great way.
There you go. Hopefully you guys had a lot of fun going through Chrome Marmot's history with us, and I know we had a lot of fun making it.
We sure did. I got to sit in a little room in my underpants and work all day long.
A little too much information, but
we'll see you on the next one.
Yes, we'll see you on the next one.